wondering on these spring, summer days, when you've been able to sit out on your porch or your deck or been able to get outside in nature, I wonder what is fascinating you. What is it that you like to watch and what fascinates you? I know for some it's hummingbirds. They like to see the hummingbirds coming to their hummingbirds' feeders. I know for others it is flowers and seeing the different flowers come into blossom. I know for some it is birds. They watch for birds and try and identify them. One of the things that fascinates me is butterflies. It began in seventh grade. As I look back on my life now, I realize that it was probably a pivotal event that led me towards science, which eventually led me towards medicine, and God continues to move me around, as you know. But it was a seventh grade science project. We were to collect bugs and have that as a presentation in class, and I decided to collect and present butterflies. And I had 7, 8, or 9, I really don't remember. I have to admit, I was, I think, about 57 when I finally threw it away. Can you imagine dead butterflies that many years later? But that's how much it meant to me. Butterflies, they just are so beautiful to me. I love the way they flutter. I love the way they land to get nectar at times. But this is my question about butterflies. Are they born again? You know their development, they begin as eggs. They're sitting there rather lifeless. Then they turn into caterpillars. Those caterpillars eat. They shed their skin 4 or 5 times. They grow to about 100 times their initial size. And then it turns into what would look like a cocoon. It's really called a chrysalis. And that caterpillar creates that chrysalis around itself, kind of an entombment, a cocoon around itself, and then it sits there. It sits there sometimes for weeks, sometimes even for months. But it's there, and it's being sheltered, and it's waiting to be born. And eventually, it cracks, and you begin to see the wings of the butterfly extend, and then it just hangs there for a while. Hangs there so the wings can dry out, so the wings can be filled with fluid, so it can get strong enough to fly away, and then finally, it flies away as an adult butterfly. It has new life. It flies on its wings and mates, and that is its purpose in that stage. I oftentimes look at life and faith like that. There are many people who don't really have a faith. Their faith is either non-existent, they don't even know it, they don't have it, or it's something they have, but it really doesn't have an impact on their lives. They're like an egg sitting there, lifeless, with a seed in it. God created each and every one of us with a spirit in us, so that seed of faith is in them. I see others who have faith, but they crawl around, and they seem to crawl throughout their lives, and their faith never seems to go any further. I see some who seek shelter in their faith. They have faith for the primary reason for their own shelter and their own protection, and they use it as a shield around them, but not as a life force in them. And then I see some who are alive, like butterflies, flying around, fluttering from one flower to the next. I see them with new life and new birth, filled with excitement, filled with a difference that is inexplicable to those who look around and wonder. So, is a butterfly born once or is it born twice? Once or twice? Does that sound familiar to you? Because that's exactly the conversation that Jesus and that and Nicodemus had. Jesus is saying you need to be born twice. You need to be born of the flesh and the spirit. You need to be born again. Or as the new RSVP puts it, you need to be born from above. Jesus is saying you need to be born more than once. And Nicodemus is saying, how is that possible? Are we born once or twice? head around. He couldn't understand it, and he didn't know why Jesus would talk the way he did. If we study the insect world, they talk about metamorphosis, complete and incomplete metamorphosis. Incomplete metamorphosis is like a grasshopper. How many thought they were going to come for a science lesson? God created science, so don't worry about it. Anyway, incomplete is like grasshoppers. A grasshopper doesn't begin the way it ends, but it has basically the same shape the entire time. Complete metamorphosis is when they totally change. And I believe in the Christian world, and I believe in the world of faith, that we live in those two worlds of metamorphosis. So many are incomplete metamorphosis. That is to say, they have accepted the faith, but they have remained pretty much the same person. Like the nymph stage in a grasshopper. They are pretty much the same. They put on the faith as another layer in their lives, but they aren't truly completely transformed. Their metamorphosis doesn't go all the way. It's not like a caterpillar who suddenly turns into a cocoon and bursts forth as a butterfly. When Jesus is talking today, he's looking at Nicodemus, and he's looking at so many people of faith who continue to crawl, or who continue to use their faith as a shelter, but who have never really burst forth into the new life through the new birth that Jesus is so desperately trying to explain to Nicodemus. He sees Nicodemus, I think he sees many of us in our faith, whether we are in church or outside of church, who have that incomplete metamorphosis. We place faith on top of who we are, but we continue to be who we are. The life-changing, powerful force of the Holy Spirit working in our lives isn't evident because we continue to live out our life every day. Nicodemus was one of the best educated people. He was a philosopher. He was well known and status in his society. He was seen as the elite. Anybody would look up at him. And Jesus looked at him and recognized that he was missing the new birth. So how do we describe the new birth? What is different about those who have the new birth? I think if I read scriptures, look at all the different four gospels, I think Jesus and Paul after him continued to try and explain to people what the new birth was. How it would be different once you experience that new birth, once you're born from above, as Jesus says it. And I think they struggled trying to find metaphors that people would understand. Jesus once said that the kingdom of God is like a treasure. You go in a field and you suddenly find a treasure. You give everything that you have so you can buy that field so you can have that treasure. That's what the kingdom is like. It's so exciting. You want it, no matter what. Or it's like a merchant seeking after pearls. They want those pearls, those beautiful pearls, and they'll do anything for those pearls. Jesus says it's like yeast permeating in the back. It begins, that new birth begins like a small seed in your faith, in your life, but it begins to grow until it permeates all that you do. He says it's like a sowing seed. Sometimes it takes root. Sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes it's complete. Sometimes it's not. So what's the difference? As you look at your life today, would you say you're born again? Born from above? You move from that infant stage of faith to crawling in your faith to eventually sheltering your faith, but then beginning to have that new birth and then finally have that completely reborn attitude, reborn spirit, reborn sense of self in such a way that people no longer see the old person you were. Paul said we are born anew. We are a new creation. We are a new creature. We are so different by being born again that people don't even recognize the old us. So what does that look like? Well, I think it first means that you begin to dislike and even hate you treat someone unfairly, perhaps those you live with, perhaps in the middle of the COVID season when we're all sequestered in our homes day after day after day after day, perhaps you felt remorseful and wanted to seek forgiveness for something you said. Sorrowful for sin in the world, sorrowful to see our world so torn apart over so many things, and compassionate for others, compassionate for those who have suffered with COVID, compassionate for those who mourn the loss of their loved ones to this disease. Compassion, just your heart is stirred. And grateful for life, you're just grateful for life because you realize how valuable it is. My sister-in-law had a double lung transplant. And ever since, I don't know that she or I were on Facebook before a double lung transplant, but ever since, I see post after post after post about how grateful she is and how beautiful it is to wake up every day and breathe freely. Grateful for life. We hunger for spiritual things. Prayer becomes a second nature to us. We desire the Word of God. We want to worship. What's the difference for one who is born again? It's that hunger for the spiritual. And it's a desire to serve others. It's hearing that there's an opportunity to serve, and you just go and serve. I could point out in this group here today all the different ways I have seen you spontaneously been moved to one way or the other, serve in a significant way in your life into the lives of others. What does it look like? It's generous. No longer looking at how I can save $2 necessarily, though that's good. Frugality is good. But a generous heart and soul that gives freely of your time and gifts to the welfare of others. And then two more things I think that make a difference. The first is a heart that is full of love. When we are born again, we just have love for those people that pours out of us. And the people who irritate us, they may still irritate us to some extent, but the love of Christ overflowing in our hearts and lives overflows in such a way that we can't do anything but love them. And there's one last that I think should be first. And that is an awareness of a preference for the eternal. That is to have the hope of Christ. I speak not only of salvation, I speak not only of resurrection into eternal life, but I speak instead of the eternal presence of God, of the eternal presence of Christ in you, of the eternal presence of the Holy Spirit working through you, that there is such an awareness of the eternal that you no longer see things through earthly eyes, you see them through God's eyes. You begin to see the world with its suffering, and your heart is full of compassion. You see people in need and you respond. This is what God does. He changes our perspective from the world to his kingdom. Are you born again? Jesus asked Nicodemus. You can't really experience who I am in the kingdom unless you begin to be born again. And that all focuses on accepting Christ. About Wednesday of this week, the word Paul kept focusing in my mind. Paul and Paul and Paul and Paul. Anybody here affected by Paul? You raise your hands. That's not good. Well, I live with people who are affected by Paul, so I hear a word Paul a lot. Not with a very favorable attitude, may I add, but everyone in my family has horrible allergies. Not so much me, but they do. And I know so many people who have issues with allergies. And this time of year, all I hear from people is pollen. The pollen's high. I can't stand this. My allergies are really getting to me. It goes on and on and on. And I say to the Lord, what do you want me to talk about pollen about? I have no clue. I struggled with this from Wednesday until Saturday. And I'm not saying she has an issue with power. She has an issue with pollen. Pollen is all over the place. Trees and flowers and grass, it's all over the place. You dust it off, and 2 hours later, you can come and clean it off again, and the next day, it looks like you never touched it for the whole season. Pollen is all over. And I want you to turn that into a positive. Because that's what God did for me. We can't really see pollen usually. The gametes are too small. We need a microscope really to see them. But we can see the collection. We know it's all there because we can react to it. We know it's all there because we keep cleaning because of it. We don't necessarily see it, but it's all over the place. And it dawned on me on Saturday that what God is saying to me in all this is my spirit is like pollen. It is all over the place. When Nicodemus came to him in the middle of the night, wondering what it was about Jesus that was creating such a stir, that was changing so many lives, that even by his touch, or even by his voice and his command, suddenly the people were healed. What is it? What is it, Jesus? And he says, you need to be born again. The Holy Spirit is all around. God wants us to understand that his Spirit is constantly pouring out upon us so that we can be born again, so that we can see life with fresh eyes and see the eternal. To see the world strife through the eyes of hope. To see the world suffering through the heart of love. And God, every minute of every day, is pouring out his Holy Spirit so that we can be born again. Born to his kingdom. So that we see the eternal hope we have in Christ. So we live with a compassionate heart for those around us. And live a love that overflows into the lives of others. Nicodemus walked away, and we aren't quite sure whether he was ever born again or not. There are some ways that we think he is, and some ways we think he is. I listed 8 different ways that you can see that you're born again. There are many more, but just have all of them. But here's the one difference I want to encourage you to recognize. If you are born from above, if you are born again, you aren't the same as you were yesterday. The presence of God and his power in you is continuing to chisel away at your attitude, trying to help you let him be greater and you be less. Trying to help you in every way to become more like Jesus. And if you're not the same as you were yesterday, if you're feeling the presence of God in your life in a more powerful way, if you find yourself curiously responding with a desire to pray more often, or opening God's words more, or coming to a church service when you have to wear masks, if you are in any way finding yourself more desiring of God's kingdom than you did before,